This is the Power Lunch, Dickson County issues for Dickson County listeners. Now to your hosts for the Power Lunch on WDKN and the 1 FM.
Welcome into the Power Lunch here on 101.5 The 1 and WDKN. We're going to be talking about Dickson County High School, and with that, we do want to go ahead and remind you, as Kenneth was just talking about, we've got football for you this Friday night. The Cougars are traveling to Lawrence County. God bless you if you're making the journey. You could just listen on the radio, and that'll be all right, too. I don't think anybody will fault you. And the Red Hawks are on the road at Portland. So, also, Lord bless you if you decide to make either of those journeys. It's going to be cool this Friday night as well. Pack your parka with you. Pretty cool outside right now. 11:30, the time, 61 degrees out there. And Principal Joey Holley with us this morning. It's a little nippy out there, huh?
It's perfect, man. I love the fall weather. I wish I could find a place that was like this year-round. It'd be a great place to be.
Well, there are several places where it's like this most of the time, but then winter happens. So.
Right.
Vermont, well, we got it. Yeah. It is nice out there, though. And we are talking Dickson County High School today, of course. And for me, this is the easiest show I do. I talk with you guys more than I talk with anybody. So I know a little bit of what's going on up there. And I guess let's start with you guys have a big event coming up on the 30th.
We got a lot of stuff going on. But yes, the 30th is the Haunting on the Hill. It is a great thing for the community. If you wanted to do a one stop for Halloween, there is stuff. I don't know how many square feet our high school is, but it's a big place, and they have events and candy and all kind of different things that go on. And it's all student led, school sponsored, and it's really a great event. I think last year we had over 200 trick or treaters that came in the first 15 minutes or something, some crazy number. So it was really, really, really good thing, and it's great for the community.
Now, where did the idea for that program come? Because we talk about parents looking for a safe environment to take the kids in the modern day. You know, when you were young or I were young, parents just drop you off in a neighborhood,
right,
go about your business, and
good
you
luck.
Come back. Yeah. Good luck. We're all counting on you. But parents are concerned. They're looking for a place to take the kids, let them dress up, and get safe candy. So what was the genesis of this program?
Nikki Akins is the leader. She is a teacher at our school. Actually, she's a former student of mine also, bless her. But she is the ringleader over this program. And her students, like I said, it's all student-led. And we've even had former students to want to come back to help with it because they've played such a vital role in getting it started. But they started the idea, and it's just kind of grown from there. It started out kind of as a small thing. Let's just see how it goes. We literally go from the gym all the way probably to the end of the 300 hall. It just goes all the way down. And a lot of our clubs, we've got a big meeting coming up this week, I believe, going over it. And a lot of our clubs participate. I think even the drama clubs puts on a little haunted house or a little haunted hall type thing. And there's even an age level for that if your kids are little, you know, there's a version for them probably, and then older kids, there's a scarier version on the other side. So
I think I saw even doing a hayride this year as part of the
program. Weather permitting, you know, I think one year we thought about doing that and it rained, but there's a lot of plans, and we can probably, I would have more information after the meeting, but it's a great event for sure for the community.
It is an interesting situation, though, to open the hill up to not just a football fan or a basketball fan, but to the entire community. That's something that I would think fairly unique around this area. I don't know how often a high school opens itself up to the general public and says, "Y'all bring the kids and let's do trick or treating." So I thought that was a very cool event to talk
about. I've got the information up. I was looking at it while we were talking. It's just $2 admission or just 2 canned food items that goes for to get in per person. And all of this goes to the Dickson Help Center, which is the main reason that we do it. But all of the things that are listed, there's games, there's a dance party, a haunted hallway, face painting, basketball. There'll be inflatables, games, photo booths, hayride, petting zoo. musical performances, an online costume contest, which I'm sure that will be interesting, musical instrument, and more. So there's no kid. And then obviously the trick or treating, but there'll be concessions available at a small cost. And once again, all proceeds is not going to Dickson County High School, but to help support the Dickson County Help Center. So it's a really good event.
Which is a great thing. Anytime you can help the Help Center, it's worthwhile. Well, with that, we're going to talk more about what goes on within the hallways of Dickson County High School. This is the 45th year. Is that right?
We started in 72, yeah, so 28 plus, yeah.
Yeah,
45th year
on the Hill. We'll talk. Of course, you haven't been there for all of those.
No, absolutely not. A good bit of them, though.
We'll talk more about that when we return. Dickson County High School, the focus of our spotlight today as we continue our school system series after this Bloomberg Real Estate Report brought to you by TriStar Bank. Welcome back on the Power Lunch here. Robert Palmer, that's my kind of music, bringing us back on the Power Lunch. 11:40 the time this morning as you're scrambling about midday lunch hour and taking a few minutes to sit with us and talk. We've got Principal Joey Holley from Dickson County High School as we continue our school series program. I enjoy this program because it gives us an opportunity to talk with each of the schools. There's something unique about every school in Dickson County. If you get a chance, go in to the schools. Don't just walk in for fun, but check in at the office and ask them how you can help. I know, I think back to the eclipse days and how I saw on social media, everyone was concerned about how are the parents or how are the kids going to be kept up with by the teachers? Obviously, that's not a problem in Dickson County. They're basically adults at this point. Hopefully, you can trust them. But, one of the things that I always say is volunteer your time. They'll find a way to use you at the different school systems. So we're talking Dickson County High School today, though. And we just mentioned the fact 45 years, or this is the 45th year that the school has been there. And Principal Holley, we were talking off air about the fact that to some extent, your school has seen some pretty heavy duty overhauls. Most people probably noticed, specifically at the pool, the windows being changed out. But you also got new bathrooms. I think I heard the other day that from Mr. Clifton that they were finishing or working on the bathrooms around the gym. Is that right?
Absolutely. Yeah, we have just received a tremendous blessing. And I'd like to kind of confirm and make it very clear. I think a lot of times people that may are not kind of in the know that think that we don't do anything to our older buildings. And I'd like to take this opportunity to let everyone know that our school has received a tremendous amount of funding for several things. The first thing that they worked on, I guess, around 2 years ago from now was the HVAC. The HVAC in basically three-fourths of the building is all new, and it made a tremendous difference. We have kids now complain that it's cold in our school, and that has never been the case unless it was winter. But we've got all new HVAC, and then kind of in the middle of that project, we received the funds, or the county received the funds, to replace every exterior window and door in the school. So even every classroom that had an exterior door going out, I think it was for twofold, but it's obviously a big safety issue also on the majority of these doors, especially the doors that are going into a classroom. There's no handle, so there's no way to get in that door. For safety purposes, that is just tremendous. The windows are tinted. They're just beautiful. The overall outlook of the school now, if you haven't seen it in a while and you go up there now, it's a noticeable difference, and the school just looks great right now.
Well, one of the things that I thought was interesting talking with Mr. Clifton a couple of weeks ago was whether you're talking about those bathrooms that you had redone or...
Yeah, I hadn't got there yet.
Or the windows or the HVAC units. He said granted, there were piecemeal patchwork things done, but that's the original units.
Right. Some of the units have, you know, they've been worked on so much. There's, you know, you may not even find parts for some of it. So they've taken a lot of those wall units out. I think just about every wall, mm-hmm. old wall unit is out, and the new HVAC is in, which is great. And then, you know, the restrooms, it's always been, you know, almost embarrassing when we have the public at basketball games or volleyball games in the gym, or when we have homecoming, the bathrooms. You can imagine what bathrooms look like if they're 10 to 20 years old, and if, you know, 1,600 kids are using it per day, they're going to be used. They're going to be, messed up a little bit. But now, also, I didn't add this to what we spoke about earlier. They have redone every bathroom in the entire school. The only ones left now are the ones by the pool and the upper concession area where our walk-in history is upstairs. And they're presently working on those, and the goal is to get them ready before our first home basketball game. So when you go by now, I'll be proud to take you to the restrooms. And, you know,
that's not something you say often.
No, it wasn't. And, you know, when you got, you know, sometimes when you have visitors in, you want to show them your best, and that was something that was kind of hard to do. But now, basically, the whole campus is new restrooms, and you can only imagine what that does to a school. And the end result, as far as the day-to-day in the school, you know, students, they take care of things that look nice. And if something doesn't look good or doesn't look nice, they don't really – it's hard to have pride in something that doesn't look good. So, to me, I've always felt like, you know, if we can keep them clean – and obviously they're brand new now, but the students will respect that more, and they'll have more pride into it, and they would actually probably get upset if some other student tried to do something that was deteriorating to it. So they look incredible now, and it's our goal to keep them that way now.
It's interesting that you say that, because when you said that, it resonated with me to an extent. When I was in school, we started to get what is standard now, kind of the steel frame desks with the desktop built into them, I guess. But the newer desks, I guess they were quartz or some kind of top on them. But we still had a few classrooms that had those old wooden and metal desks. And it just seemed easier if I was chewing gum, which I never did because that's a demerit at school. But if I was chewing gum, it was always easier to stick it to the ugly desk than it was to stick it to the new one. And you don't really think about that, especially at the high school level. But the appearance of the facilities matter.
Well, it does. And, you know, when you've got 1,500 to 1,600 students. I don't know what our number is exactly right now. We're 1,550 plus. Mm-hmm. This summer we were right at 1,600. I don't know what our number is exactly right now. But when you've got that many students, you know, even if 1% decide to do something a little uncharacteristic, that's still 15 kids that can be on a mission, you know, to do things. But the one thing that we have noticed so far, you know, knock on wood, but the students take care of things, and then when they look better. And they have more pride in it. And we have seen that so far. And we've got a great student body on the Hill. And they're as special as anyone to me. So it's a really a great group of students.
Well, you mentioned when we were talking about the bathrooms, I don't want to misname. I call it the Lobby of Fame or the Hall of Fame. But you all have done a great amount of work on the display outside of the gym upstairs for folks that might not have seen it during basketball season. That's been a point of pride for y'all.
Yeah, it's been a big deal. One of the things that we did this summer, it was one or two days before school started, we had a faculty meeting, and our theme this year is I'm so glad for DC. My first 2 years, it was all in for DC. And this year, I just asked teachers to write on a piece of paper what's the number one reason they like Dickson County High School, or what they love about Dickson County High School. And I kind of thought I would know the ultimate answer, but I just kind of wanted to see it, to get a visual out of it, too. And they took that piece of paper, wrote on it, and then we kind of split in half in the auditorium. And then just as an activity, you just threw your piece of paper at someone else across the room. So, you know, the 100 sheets of paper flying across the room, and then everyone was responsible for picking up one. And then we had everyone read out loud what their thing was. And basically it got down to three things, and it was students, tradition, and family is the three most important things about our school. And that's what makes our campus so special, I believe. It's just a big family. We've got a lot of new teachers there, and they are just really impressed with how people take them in. It's almost like going to church. You know, you got a welcoming committee, and we always take care of our own. And that's what's so special, you know, about our school. So the students are obviously a big plus, and tradition and family. So these are three things that we take a lot of pride in. So,
well, you mentioned it being like a family and new teachers coming in. It's been interesting to me over the last few years. Some of the great teachers that we all think of, Mr. Jones, for example, some of them have started to step aside, and you have to replace those people. Do you all have like a Cougar Pride introduction course for teachers that come in, or how do you acclimate a teacher to that environment?
Well, we like to think, you know, that once you join the family, that it's, running short of words, it's catchy, you know, it's contagious, that you join in. We have very few that just don't understand it. We had, I think we had 10 new teachers, even to the community this year. And when they got to witness homecoming, it was just something they just couldn't believe. I noticed a lot of social media posts that they sent back home to show people, hey, you guys, we thought we had a homecoming. This ours was nothing compared to what I've just witnessed. And they had a lot of videos and pictures. So it is very contagious. And I'm sorry, I didn't finish my other when I started talking about the tradition, the walk in history upstairs. I'm sorry, I got off path there. The walk in history upstairs is we wanted to show everything, you know, in the past 40 plus years that our school's been in existence, some of the more interesting things that have went on in there, and what's so cool about our school and why everyone has so much pride in our school. You know, we have several during homecoming. We probably have, I don't know, maybe 700 to 1,000 people that comes to homecoming that are all alumni. We ask all alumni to stand. It's just incredible. Graduation, we do the same thing. It's incredible how many people actually graduated our school. So, Jason Tigert had an idea of, trying to promote that in the best way we could. He was trying to kind of, he had some ideas from some other schools, and we just kind of labeled it a walk in history. And what we've got televisions up there that's got over 1,500 pictures loaded on them. Wow. That's from the 1972 year on, pretty much. And it's just one television's got nothing but homecoming, attendance, queens, courts, games, and all things homecoming, floats, you know, the parades. There's all on that one. We've got another television that's got nothing but something to do with magazines, or the magazine sales or assemblies, and we have that going on. We've got one that's sports, and it's nothing but sports pictures, all athletic. And then we've just got one that's just, you know, when I asked some of the faculty, we literally just took pictures of the annuals and then just, you know, streamed it into a video. I said, if something looks cool in an annual, take a picture of it. You know, the days back when Mr. Caudill would wear a pink tux to a magazine assembly, just stuff like that back in the day was just, you know, he was so far ahead of his time. The things that he created and built in 1972, we're still doing today. You know, some of the graduation speech, the spiel that we do is his words that, you know, are still that we've used today. So we just wanted to promote everything cool about our school. And that's what's on the televisions. We've got it in four sections. On one side, we've got a huge trophy case on the end that's got all of our best stuff. You know, if a team won a state, that trophy's in there, or the highest, even golf with a region championship, that's the highest they've been. That trophy's in the trophy case. We've got it sectioned off in four. Of course, softball kind of, they have their own section, and so does basketball, to be honest with you, and football. But it's a unique way of just showing off. Our trophy case is in the auditorium lobby, and very few people really get to go to the auditorium lobby, and more people go, you know, they'll go to plays and to choir concerts, but obviously there's probably more people that would go to a basketball game. So it's just a way of, and that's the door that everyone goes through. So when they walk in, that's what they see. And that was the whole goal. But those sections that we have a section that's just for state champions, like a 25% of that entire wall is for state champions. And then there's another section of, I think we call it the Elite Award. I can't remember exactly what it's labeled. It's been a while since I've been up there. But those that, like Brooklyn Lee, got Gatorade Player of the Year twice, Lele Carter, McDonald's All-American, their pitchers are up there, and we're going to expand on that. Where it's at now is just we spent the money that we had on it and designed it the way we wanted, but we would like to get more up there. And then we have at the next level a section up there for sports, all of our students that are playing at college at the next level. And we've got, you know, several, the pitchers when they were Cougars up there, and then we got a nameplate of whatever college they're at with their name on the plate. And then the fourth and final section is something that's a work in progress, but we're wanting to start an educator hall of fame. We've never had that before at this school, and that section of the wall is going to be for that. Then the opposite side of that wall is all academic. We've got athletics pretty much on one side. The other side is all academic. We've got boards up there with plaques and or plates of every valedictorian, every salutatorian, every gold, silver, and bronze medalist, and then every boys and girls citizenship that's ever had since 72 is on that list. And
we need a bigger wall.
Yeah, right. Well, it's been it's really neat up there to visit, and especially if you're from there. It's fun going to basketball games and just watching people just look at the television screens, just looking at the pictures, and you can just see like eventually their time will come up, you know, when they were in school, and they'll see something that reminds them. So it's a very cool thing. And we've on the other wall, we've got a backdrop kind of like you'd see Nick Saban when he's talking. You know, he's got the Alabama logos behind him. And Miss Patricia Hudson in our art department designed that wall, all things Cougars. So it's a backdrop to when we have college signings and any cool picture we want to put in social media or on paper or whatever, that's usually our backdrop. It's just something. It's not sponsored by AT&T or and all those, but it's all things Cougar. So it's a really neat wall. And it's a great way to celebrate and to recognize our past. And that's exactly what we use it for.
And if you haven't seen it yet, your first opportunity will be coming up on November 16th. I think that's right. Yes, November 16th, Shelbyville comes to play at Dickson County High School for basketball. I mean, I'm sure Principal Holley would be glad to give you a tour anytime. But,
sure.
Basketball games are a lot easier. You can come out and support the Cougars and Lady Cougars. We're going to take our next break for news. When we come back, Principal Holley mentioned homecoming. Homecoming is like nowhere else at Dickson County High School. We'll talk a little bit about that because I think that's one of the things, and I'm sure you agree, that makes Dickson County better in my mind than just about any school out there.
Second to no one.
That is accurate. We will take a break. Back in a moment on the Power Lunch on 101.5 The One and WDKN. Power Lunch who can it be now? Well, it's Freeman and Principal Joey Holley here talking about Dickson County High School. And one of the things that, you know, when we talk about these different schools, we like to talk about what makes that school special. And before the break, we were discussing homecoming. I don't know. I would imagine Mr. Caldill and some others had something to do with this, but I don't know the full genesis of how we began homecoming. I know somewhere in the 80s or 90s, we went from flowers and chicken wire to the little balls, and now we're using quarter and eighth sheets to make little balls. The floats are just next level. I don't know how we got to this point. Someone should write a book about it, but certainly I've had the privilege of being at a few other teams' homecomings. Brentwood comes to mind. They don't know what homecoming is, do they?
No, it was funny the other night. Ravenwood, two of their coaches and whoever else they had represent them up in the press box was commenting on the floats from a distance, and they were just amazed, you know, at the quality of those floats. And I think one even mentioned the Macy's Parade. So that's quite a compliment coming from a Williamson County school. Mr. Caudill had everything to do with the start of everything Dickson County High School and is responsible for what it's turned into now. I mean, the vision that he had, and I've talked to several about this, but, you know, when you think of building a float, you know, you don't think of, there's probably, I don't know, maybe 10 to 50 life lessons that come with this float within a class. And, you know, you got a class of 350 to 400 kids, and they start with an empty trailer, and then what they turn into on Thursday is just unbelievable. Probably the thing that, you know, Mr. Caudill, when he was thinking about it, I mean, I don't know exactly what he was thinking. I think other people were doing floats. But the camaraderie that's built within the class and within the students, and just the bond that kids make through this week is just incredible. You have other classes helping each other out. They're not just, you know, it's not just about their class. We had two classes that got done early this year, and they went to other classes to help them finish their floats. That's just very uncommon. You know, it is, that is one way of looking at it. As far as going from flowers to what it is now, I would say that our school is based on competition. You know, with the magazine drive, we try to be the number one school in the nation every year. We have been for, I don't know, since the 80s. You know, that's a thing. Homecoming, you know, you've got class coordinators. There's three class coordinators that are teachers at school that are the class coordinators of a specific class, and those guys don't like to lose. And they want to do whatever they can to win, whether it be the skit or the float or whatever. The skits this year were unbelievable. Every year you think you've seen it all, and then they just take it up another level. This year was just incredible. A lot of the videos that's out on social media is really cool to see what the kids come up with and the teachers. But it's just a special thing at our school. It's, like I said, it's, I feel like it's second to none. Someone may be close to equal, but they're not better. And there's just a lot of pride, a lot of competitive events that go on throughout the week. You know, you've got skit, a float, a sign, the pep rally, and the floats. It's just a, it's just an incredible sight. It wears you out. You know, there's not many schools, also, to be honest with you, that can open their doors from 3 o'clock till 10 o'clock Sunday through Thursday, or Sunday through Wednesday, and then stay open till 12 on Thursday night and not have a bunch of riffraff. I can honestly say this year there's close to 1,600 students at our school. We did not have one major problem at all on campus. You think of all the opportunities that could have happened, and there's a lot of schools can't do that. And, you know, quite honestly, a lot of schools can't even have an assembly with everyone in the gym at the same time because of what might happen. We don't have that worry here. We've got a great school, and there's a lot of things that you can do when you've got that kind of momentum going for you.
That's an interesting point that you bring up, because when I was in school, even as a freshman, my dad, I think, believed a lot the way I believe, which is that every night you're not at homecoming, you will regret in 10 or 15 years. And I was there every night, both years I was at Dickson County High School. And he had no qualms about, you know, I would stay after school. You know, sometimes we walked all the way down to Mathis Drive to get a snack. We'd walk back. And we'd be there until our parents came and picked us up, whenever shutdown time was back in 2000. And parents don't have to worry about that. They don't have to think, oh my gosh, what are they going to get into in the parking lot, or what are they going to be doing? They just don't. Kids, we literally do. I say we. They literally do. Go over to the building, roll balls, glue them, stick things together, build a float. That's what they're doing. You might walk away and get a drink, socialize, mm-hmm. or whatever, but you're building a float. And I think that's something that, like you said, I don't know what school you would be able to do that in that we compete with in football, for example. I don't know where you'd be able to go that the kids wouldn't get into some kind of trouble in that situation.
Well, it's a comforting thing as a parent. I mean, I've had my second ones up there now, and I would never dream of sending them anywhere else other than Dickson County High School. But it's just a special place, and that all started from day one with Mr. Caudill when he started it. You know, we asked kids to, you know, act their age and be responsible, you know, for their decisions. And, you know, we're not a perfect school by any stretch of the imagination. We have our own issues, just like other schools. Mr. Caudill's famous thing that he used to always say is that we major in the minors. We take care of the little things so big things don't happen. So that's one thing that we try to hold true to. And that's what keeps our school running. We always have challenges like any other schools. There's always students that'll try you. And but we try to treat them right and do what's right and expect our kids to act right. And it's an awesome school. I'm just blessed to be a small part of a great school and a great tradition.
With that, we're going to take another break. When we come back, without tooting our horn here at the radio station, there is an aspect of Dickson County High School that I think is very unique. Not a lot of schools have their own radio show, and we'll talk about that when we return. Coach Troy is a heck of a host.
Absolutely.
We'll discuss that when we return on the Power Lunch on 101.5 The One and WDK. Welcome back on the Power Lunch. Just a few more minutes here with Principal Holley before we let him head back to do the good work on the Hill. What does a principal do between about 11 and 1 o'clock? Lunch and...
During the day?
Yeah. What else do you have going on this time of day?
Every day something's different. Sometimes lunch is at 11:30. Sometimes it's 1. Sometimes it's not all day at all.
Sometimes it's when I get home for dinner.
Sometimes you just miss it. It's just every day is a new challenge, if you tried to set in stone something that you were doing at blank time, other than the Power Lunch, it would be difficult to do. Today, to be honest with you, we've got 1,600 students basically taking the ACT. The seniors are getting to take their retake today, and we're using our time to let the freshmen, sophomores, and juniors get another one under their belt. And so they're actually just about finishing up with that right now, if not already finished. And then we're celebrating the rest of the afternoon. To be honest with you, I thought about seeing if we could do a live remote, but I figured it would be kind of tough.
We could have done that.
Yeah, maybe next time. Yeah. But we haven't got to talk much about this, but for the first time, I believe, in the history of our school, we received a level 5 in the state of Tennessee for taking the state test based on gains. You know, if our students were supposed to make an 80, they probably made an 85 instead of just making the 80. And we earned a level 5 score, which is top level you can get in the state. And while the students were taking the test, or before we started taking the test, I had made a statement that if we could reach a level 3, that we would have a free day and free food and just kind of have a field day one day. And I didn't really mention what we would do if it was a level 5 because I didn't ever see that coming. But today, our cafeteria staff is going to feed our kids for free. And then afterwards, we have rented those inflatable houses or obstacle courses and things. Mm-hmm. And right now, the football field is covered in inflatables right now. There's a company that's put them all together, and our kids are going to be down there in about 15 minutes. But we're celebrating and rewarding our kids for doing such a great job on those tests. So the seniors will be walking down there inside of 20 minutes, and some don't even know they're down there. I think some do, but they're going to just get a chance to just kind of chill and relax and jump on those things or not, but just sit out in the sun if nothing else, because we're celebrating today earning that level five. So and we're very excited about what's going on.
That's a big thing, because people hear us talk with Dr. Weeks in here a lot, and Dr. Faulkner, and we talk about the gains and getting kids caught up. It's really a matter of getting the school system caught up and advancing. And when you see something like that, a level five, which, as you mentioned, it's kind of in the business world, we would call it over last year or growth from last year. You're talking about kids that are making strides as students, which is not an easy thing to do.
No.
And you guys have instituted some unique programs as well. I know you have different time throughout the day that's blocked out for students to get extra help as well.
We basically, I won't say we did. We pretty much gutted everything that we were doing in the past and started a new plan last year, and did not expect the results that we got so quick. Usually anything that you do with change or anything new takes time. We were kind of all shocked that we received the level five, but we're more standards focused now in the classroom, and so that when we're covering, we're basically the teachers in every tested area are deciding what standards they're going to cover for the next 2 weeks. And then without a shadow of a doubt, those three teachers are teaching those standards. We don't tell them how to preach it. We just said, cover these standards. And then at the end of 2 weeks, they're coming up with an assessment based on those standards, asking questions about only the standards and nothing else. And it's just, our teachers have always worked their tails off. Our students have always worked their tails off. But now we're just a little bit more focused on the standards. Now at the end of 2 weeks, we take that assessment. Our teachers can grade it with a phone. We're using a lot of more technology. They can grade it on a phone. That data goes immediately into a program that's a web-based program, PowerSchools, and it gives us all the data that we need to understand how the students did on the test. Not only do we know grades, but we know if, say, if only 25% of your kids got one particular question right, well, we know we didn't teach that right. Right. It could be a bad question, but we designed the question, so it shouldn't be a bad question. But they didn't understand what we were trying to teach. So they can then roll that in for the next few weeks to make sure that they hit back on that standard, that the students didn't miss. If a student's really struggling in a specific area, let's say algebra or any tested area, we now know. We don't have a guess that's a kid struggling, but we have a more of a focus knowing, okay, they don't understand this standard. So we've got what we call CP, Cougar Pause time, 25 minutes a day that they go get help from that teacher covering that standard, and they stay in there until they understand it. On the flip side of that, you might have been this student, it wouldn't have been me, but those that get it, the ones that are smart, I was not that student, but the ones that get it and make great grades and they're sitting over there just twiddling their thumbs while the teacher's trying to help all the ones that don't get it, we've got a plan for them. We've got an enrichment program that I would call second to none that we started last year that gives those students an opportunity to go do something cool that aren't just sitting around wasting time, just bored out of their skull. So we've got things like welding, survival skills, scuba diving, wilderness. There's so many other things that I'm going to Latin. We've got 38 topics that the kids can choose from, different topics that they can go do. That's fun. That just gives them a break from the normal monotony and that they can go do this while those others are getting help with tutoring. The great thing about the tutoring in is once those students show that they know what they're doing, then they get to go do indoor soccer or intramurals or all the other cool things that we've got going on during this 25-minute period. So that's helped added another kind of extra oomph to what we've been doing for the school also.
You said that as we started, you said I might have been one of those kids, but I'll tell you, for me personally, hearing you say that you're giving an incentive to a student that excels and giving them something interesting to do as opposed to just here, do some busy work while I teach the kids that are struggling. That would have been one of the greatest things I could have dealt with in high school, because I felt for a long time we raised the floor, but we didn't do anything at the ceiling. And that trapped a lot of kids that were just bored.
Well, you've got a lot of students that sometimes they get help to help tutor students, which is great. We have a lot of students that would love to do that. But, you know, to have the opportunity to just we had mythology,
and see their current issues, learning things.
That's I wish I had the list in front of me, but there was like 38 topics that the kids could choose from that are just really interesting. HOSA, health science, nursing, a lot of things are coming. Auto mechanics, basic carpentry, a lot of things like that that the students can get, you know, if they're getting it. And we have study hall also, three or four of those that students can, you know, some of the upper level students just want time to do their homework. You know,
sure.
So that's also great for them too. They can only enroll in one of those. We try to get them involved in the other stuff, but it's just an added piece that just gives our students a little bit, you know, more reason to want to come to school. You know, if I don't make great grades, but I've got the opportunity to go weld and I would love to learn how to weld, well, maybe that's the reason I come to school in the first place. You know, I'm not in athletics. I don't care about plays or band or anything, but man, that FFA program or the welding program or to be a nurse, I'm interested in that, and that would keep me wanting to come back to school. So it was all, a lot of that was designed by several great people at our school. I'm not taking credit for any of this. It was a combined effort of a lot of ideas and thought processes that go behind this, but it worked. And like I said, we didn't expect this kind of gains right off the start. It's going to be hard to keep that level, but we're not going backwards. We don't want to go back to where we were. And we're going to work as hard as we ever have. The other piece to that, you know, in the past, we've also made our students more accountable. In the past, we used to always do assessments, and the students knew that it didn't matter what grade they made on it. It didn't even matter if they tried because it wasn't graded. We changed that to where it does matter. It's now 40% of their grade, these assessments, so they've got to take them serious because it's a normal test. It's nothing different. So that helped us out too.
I know when you made some of these changes and there was the adjustment last year, there were a lot of critics.
Oh yeah.
And I'm sure you got phone calls, angry mama visits,
a lot of those,
that sort of thing. Have you heard, because I know the parents have seen the gains just in their kids, but also then when you get that level 5 rating and the test scores come back and parents see the growth numerically, not just in what they mm-hmm. notice at home. Have you had anybody say, you know, good job?
I've had some of my friends that are some of my worst critics, I guess I should say, that was really complaining about certain things. And then they kind of crawfished at the end and realized, okay, this was awesome. I appreciate what's going on. I think it takes time and change with any of us, anything that we're doing. I think I heard a great quote a week ago, and I won't get the words correctly right, but none of us really resist change. Just don't change me, you know?
That's fair enough.
For all practical purposes, that wasn't exactly verbatim, but, you know, we don't mind if someone else is going through change. Just don't mess with me. But it was tough. It was, you know, when I've always considered myself to be a competitive person, and, you know, we could just always do what we've always done. And you just get what you always get, and you could accept it, or you get competitive and get, you know, ticked off a little bit about it and say, we're not a level 1 school, and that's what we were and had been for a while, and let's do something different. Let's try to figure out something else that might work. So I don't think that this was the only reason that we achieved a level 5. There's several factors. But it was a small piece in what made it successful, and we're not changing anything. We have fine-tuned it. We've critiqued it a little bit, but the basic message is the same. The students are held accountable. We're teaching standards. Just for example, you know, sometimes in English we get really caught up on To Kill a Mockingbird, you know, the book, and the book's a great read, and it's a great book, but that's not what we're tested on.
Right.
We're not testing them. They're not asking questions about To Kill a Mockingbird. They're questioning us on the standard. So we're still using those books. We're reading them, but we're not spending 9 weeks on those when, you know, it's probably maybe a week or two tops. We're just using to read that to learn how we need to get better tuned on the standard. So that's been the great blessing of it. I think we're more on the same page. We've got three teachers that are working together. They're not rogue out on their own. They're all focused. They're teaching the exact same thing. And then we're testing. And, you know, the teachers see how their students do. We have meetings every 2 weeks where we kind of flash the numbers up there. Here's your class's average on this test. And, you know, normally they're really close. And as long as they're close, we know everyone's doing what they're supposed to do. If you're teaching and you're teaching, your class is making an 88 and somebody over here is teaching and making an 87 and I'm doing an 86, we're all pretty good. But if you're an 88, you're an 87 and I'm a 72, something's not right. What happened? You know, we're teaching the exact same thing.
Sure.
The grade should be the same. I don't care what's, we all have the same students. There's no, you know, big change here. So, our teachers have kind of, I think, a little bit more accountability, not that they have never been accountable, but just a little bit more throughout the year, you know, by taking these tests every 2 weeks. In the past, in April, we just kind of keep our fingers crossed and just hope that we do good on the test. The second week of August last year, we knew where our kids stood. Then we knew who knew it, who didn't, and we got them immediate help. So it's, that change has helped. But I got to tell you, the taste of finally receiving a level 5 for our school has literally changed the culture another notch at our school, because we now feel like we can rub elbows with the better schools in the state, and just got to figure out a way to keep it up. So,
And of course, maintaining that's a tough thing, because again, we're talking year over year, but
right.
It's certainly an interesting program. If you have a student at Dickson County High School, you have to feel like they're in good shape. And as we wrap up here with Principal Holley, I teased it earlier. If you want to know what's going on at Dickson County High School, Coach Troy does a phenomenal job with the Cougar Report. You can hear it Thursday mornings as a part of my show from 7 to 7:30. You just tune in. And he has, I told him the other day at a football game, I said, I learned stuff on your show. Because the different groups he had in the Anglophiles a few mm-hmm. weeks ago. People don't even know what an Anglophile is.
If you want to know what's going on at our school, he is covering it on a weekly basis. And I'm so thankful for your radio station allowing us to do that and helping us with resources, because we wanted to do it our own. You know, we used to come down here, which was no big deal. It was fine. But to have other kids seeing other kids on the radio, and we always play it over our speaker system in the school. So the whole show is on in the school. In any classroom, you can hear what's going on. And it's just important for the kids. I mean, it's another way of promoting the kids. That's what we always try to do, is recognize them. We use social media for that also. But Coach Williams is one of a kind. He's one of my dearest friends. And he does such a great job with that radio show. Most people don't realize how much time he spends just to prepare, you know, every week to get a group. I mean, it's hard to get students there at 7 o'clock in the morning, much less one, but he's getting 4, 6. I think there's like 10 cheerleaders the other day on there, and they all show up. The teachers show up to support them. And it's just another great thing about our school, but he does an outstanding job on that radio show.
I don't know if there's many people more Cougar than Coach Troy. He's
absolutely
certainly
not.
And if you're curious, he's also the stat guy for the football team. So he's locked in on everything. Well, Principal Holley, we appreciate you taking a few minutes with us today.
Thank you for letting us come down and talk about and brag about our school and our students.
It's a great school. You can see it in action every day on the Hill. And, of course, this Friday night we've got football as well as they travel to Lawrence County looking for a win. And that's going to do it for our Power Lunch today. Go enjoy Free Day.
I'm going to. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll take a break. This Bloomberg Small Business Report is brought to you by TriStar Bank. That's going to do it for the Power Lunch. John and Heidi are next.